lifts our hearts together to that faithful God of ours. Thank you, Father, for what you are indeed faithful. At all times, in all seasons of life, in all seasons of the year, as we embark upon this new year, we look back and we see that you have indeed been faithful. As we think of the life of Mary Ford Robinson, oh, how faithful you have been to her, Hubert, and Paige, over the decades of marriage that they have enjoyed. That faithfulness is testified over and over again by the influence in so many lives that she has touched. You have proved faithful through her in so many instances. And so today we call upon your name, we thank you for your presence, we celebrate your goodness in giving the body of Christ, this community, this family, this life. And so we see you as the faithful one, ever-loving, all-consistent, all-wise God. As we come today in this service, we look to you for wisdom, power, for clarity of expression, for the Spirit to work in all of our lives to bring comfort. Yes, consolation. Yes, joy. Thank you for that, in Jesus' name, amen. You've heard Kendall Rutledge sing, Jill Lucas at the piano. In a few minutes, Becky Rhodes will be bringing some personal remarks regarding her relationship with Mary. The obituary reads this way. Mary Ford Robinson, 76, of Mount Washington. Turned to the Lord on Sunday, January 3rd, 2021, at her home. Mary was a devoted homemaker, Bible teacher, and member of First Baptist Church of Mount Washington. Mary graduated in 1962 from Sonora High School and attended Western Kentucky University. She was preceded in death by her parents, Carl and Katie Ford, siblings, Jane Wilson, Jim, Carl and Walter Ford. Mary is survived by her husband of 57 years, Hubert Robinson, one daughter, Paige Robinson, her sister, Helen Greer, husband Jim, sisters-in-law, Alma and Jane Ford. Blessed family, greatly used by the Lord. Times like this, we turn to the Scriptures for direction, for wisdom, for hope. And I felt led to move to, in the beginning of our service today, to look to the 8th chapter of Romans, that Mount Everest of the New Testament. Beginning with the 16th verse, we read these words. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans, has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit, We groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for the adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. Those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who could be against us? He who did not spare his own Son and gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, no. In all these things, we are more than conquerors. Through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. God bless the reading and hearing of your word to our hearts.
Well, for those of you who know me, you should be a little nervous. I have a microphone, and they did not give me a time limit. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Becky Rhodes. And Mary Ford Robinson has played many roles in my life over the years, as I'm sure she has with many of you. We first met about 27 years ago. When my family moved to Mount Washington, we began coming to First Baptist Church. And so I met Mary almost immediately upon coming here, and she invited me to come to her Sunday school class, which I did. And so when I first met her, I knew her as a teacher. But through the years, she has become a mentor and a very close and dear person. What an honor it is for me today, as well as for each of you, to be able to come together just to celebrate Mary's life, as well as to comfort one another in our grief over our loss, our temporary loss of her, I might say. I wish that we had the time for everyone that was here to share their connection with Mary. And how she impacted their lives. Because I know that we all have been deeply touched by her. You couldn't know Mary without being challenged by her and influenced by her. You know, Mary was a person of much love. She was an adoring wife. She loved humor so much. We had so many sweet conversations about how much she admired the way that he so tenderly led and cared for her and their daughter Paige. And she was a loving mother. Paige, you have to know how proud she was of you and how amazed she was by all your accomplishments, as well as amused by all of your antics. She loved her extended family. She loved her friends. But let it be known by everyone that her first love was her Savior. Mary's love for Christ was extraordinary. She was truly a biblical scholar, and she attributed her great love and excitement for studying God's Word to an organization that she joined in the late 70s that's called Bible Study Fellowship. She would often speak of the ladies that she had met and served with in BSF back in the early 80s. And I remember she would tell me that it was those ladies and their love of Christ that spurred her on to help her grow in her faith, her knowledge, her obedience, as well as her love of the Lord. Those were lessons that she learned, loved, and taught others well, especially those who had the privilege of studying the Bible under her teaching when she began the Joy or the Jesus, Others, and You class here at First Baptist back in 1987. Now this past spring, a group of us decided that we wanted to do a Bible study over Zoom, and we were gonna study the book of Matthew. And so we invited Mary, and she joined us in that study. And as it became very evident, all of the participants that were in that study were what I would refer to as a group of Mary's girls. Now, Mary had many girls, but when I'm talking about that specific group, we were just a group of sisters in Christ that had come to know one another through Mary. Each of us had been in a Sunday school class she had taught or in a Bible study. And I recall one week there being a question in the study that asked us, who has God used to encourage you or challenge you in your faith walk? You know, every person that was in the study that night told of something that Mary had done to help grow them in their faith and relationship with Christ. Well, now if you knew Mary well, you would know she wanted no part of the credit for any of it. And I could just see on the Zoom camera how physically uncomfortable she was becoming as she sat there listening to lady after lady share how God had used her to influence their walk with Christ. Everyone who ever sat under her teaching knew that she was someone that you could depend on for wise, godly counsel, or as Kara calls it, those pearls of wisdom. When there was a problem in one of her girls' lives, they only needed to pick up the phone and call Mary. Regardless of what she was doing, she made time for you. Now, not just to make you feel better, although much of the time you did, and she wasn't just going to fix your problem, although sometimes you just wanted her to. But what she did was a unique character trait that Mary was just so good at. She listened. She would give you the space you need to express how you felt, but then she would always very quickly point you back into the right direction. She would always you back to her Jesus. And by the time you had finished telling her what was going on, she always had a Bible verse to share. And And most of the time she would have an illustration of a Bible character who could help you understand what God might be doing in that particular situation to either refine you, to grow you, or to reveal himself to someone else. One of her favorite verses to pull out when you might be fretting over something that you feared might happen, that probably never was going to happen, was 2 Corinthians 10:5. It's casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. And she would say, now, most of the time, I don't do the King James Version. But in this particular verse, I think it is right on. At least it has been in my life. Mary was really good about keeping in touch with people and letting them know that she was not only thinking of them, but also praying for them. You know, thanks to technology, I have several years worth of our conversations memorialized through Facebook Messenger. And as I was preparing for today, I went back through those messages and I read, and I noticed in almost every conversation, Mary would ask how she could be praying for me. Or many times, if she was the one who initiated the conversations, she would begin by telling me, God has laid you on my heart and in my mind, and I want you to know, I don't know what you're going through, but I'm praying for you. There were also messages involving many of you in which she would be soliciting prayer on your behalf. Now, Mary was a wonderful confidant. She didn't share the details of what was going on in people's lives. Instead, she may just reach out and say, this particular person or this particular family really could use some prayer because they're going through a challenging time. And while I am certain that all of us could agree that she enjoyed talking to us, I think we also know that she probably spent most of her time talking to God about us. Mary lived out her faith as well as any person that I have ever known. Her words and her actions reflected her sincere love and deep commitment to Christ, and her desire to teach and encourage others in their Christian walk. She had a delightful sense of humor and a quick wit. And she used to tell me sometimes, you know, sometimes a good joke is a way to lighten a really tense moment. And she was very good at that. I want to just close today by reading a note that I wrote to Mary several years ago, and then giving you her words, her response, because I definitely think that they reflect the legacy that she lived and that was created through her life. Here's my note. Mary, I just want to thank you for all the love, support, and mentoring that you have poured into me over the years. It's amazing when I think about how instrumental you have been in growing me. This lesson was a reminder to me that you are and have always been one of my best advisors, and really the one who saw God working in me long before anyone else ever did. I love and I thank you for all you've done to expand God's kingdom and to mature his people. You will probably never know how many lives have been touched because of the works that God created for you to do. I love you dearly. To which our precious Mary replied, gosh, I hardly know how to respond. just to say like Paul, I give all the credit to God, for he is the one who put this earnest desire in my heart to encourage believing women. I'm not an evangelist. I just have a heart that needs others to challenge me to trust Christ daily. And I know
overcome. Oh, we sing hallelujah.
Friendships are often formed around a shared common interest. Folks who are part of a knitting circle, do scrapbooking together, play golf or hunt, usually form friendships that center around the thing they enjoy doing together. Very often, however, the spiritual bond between brothers and sisters in the Lord becomes stronger than these bonds of common interest connections. This is the kind of bond I'm thinking about when I recall mine and Shelby's friendship with Hubert and Mary Robinson. It began back in 1979. We had just come from 7 years of service in the Philippines with our mission board. We're in Louisville on a study leave at Southern Seminary, and we're missionaries in residence at the St. Matthew's Baptist Church in Louisville. We were living in the designated missionary house, just a block and a half or so from where the Robinsons lived. It was our happy experience to meet the Robinsons early in our stay there. Hubert was employed at the Ford plant. Mary was active in Bible studies at the church and in the popular Bible study fellowship. It didn't take long for our kindred spirits to get connected up. In the summer of 1980, and I was called out here as minister of music, First Baptist Church of Mount Washington. Not long after we came, Hubert and Mary decided to visit this church. Eventually, God led them to relocate here also and become part of our First Baptist Church family. So our friendship continued, deepened over the next 3 years until we left in 84 to go back to the Philippines to serve again. But 13,000 miles did not hinder the continuation of our friendship and our connection with the Robinsons. Whenever we had a prayer need, Mary was one of Shelby's two or three go-to people. She had been a prayer partner with Shelby ever since. As a mainstay in the church library, Mary's love for high-quality Christian books, both fiction and nonfiction, had led to much blessing and growth for many folks over the years. As a matter of fact, one of our own members just a moment ago mentioned how Mary's love for books and her knowledge of Christian literature had helped her in her reading and her Christian life. Mary's love for the book as a Sunday school teacher has spilled over into the enrichment of many women's lives that has sat under her teaching over the years. In early 2014, when we were considering a return to First Baptist Church, we were driving on the Western Kentucky Parkway. We received a call from Mary informing us that some tests were being done. There was some possibility that cancer had developed. We told her then, that day, in the car, that whether we came to Mount Washington or not, we would be there for her, for Paige and Hubert. We'd walk with them through this whole thing. Well, the church called us. We moved back to Mount Washington in the summer of 2014 and have been walking with them and with Mary through the ups and downs of her bout with cancer ever since. Though she was rather small of stature, all who knew Mary appreciated her great big heart of kindness, faith, and love for the Lord, His Word, and His church. Heard about that already. One of the hard realities of life in this world is that no matter whether we're old or young, how rich or poor we may be, we all face difficult times. James, the Lord's brother, said, "Count it all joy when you face different kinds of trials and temptations." Some preachers you hear on TV and some books written by supposedly Christian authors, claim that believers are exempt from life's tragedies and trials. But that claim is made in total disregard of the plain truth of God's word. As Paul wrote to the church in Philippi, saying, "For to you it has been granted for Christ's sake, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake." For most of us, Our first response to problems that we encounter is often to ask God to take them away or to change our circumstances. This is not an altogether unchristian approach for us to take. After all, the Apostle Paul responded to his thorn in the flesh the very same way. You're familiar with this passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Paul says, I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man was caught up into paradise. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. But God knows. This man heard things that cannot be told, which man may not utter. On behalf of this man, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not. Except of my weaknesses. Though if I should boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of those revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. I love that word, is. Right now, it is, Paul. It is, Mary. And it is for you and me. Sufficient. For my power is made perfect in your weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Paul was confident that if God had allowed this thorn to come into his life, God and only God had the power to remove it. Instead, God answered Paul by saying, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in your weakness. By God's grace, Paul was able to accept the Lord's answer. Because he did, Paul's life was powerfully used by God to reflect his glory to other people. Thus, Paul's thorn was not wasted. Because as he continued looking to Jesus, he became better equipped for the Lord's service, rather than becoming bitter and being placed possibly on the shelf. He used the word castaway in another passage. Likewise, Mary kept her eyes on the Lord Jesus. With the assurance that the Lord was working all things for her good and his glory, since she loved him and was called according to his purpose. Romans 8:28 was one passage she had clung to and claimed by faith for all of her Christian journey, especially as the cancer began to take its toll. If Mary could give testimony today, I believe she'd say something like this to us. For this cancer, I have Jesus, his promise, his presence, and his ever-present grace. Those who are reasonably healthy marvel at this kind of steady and persevering faith that Mary had in the Lord. The secret to maintaining this kind of response in the midst of disappointing lab reports, disheartening PET scan results, increasing physical weakness and pain, is the Godward view gained from extended time in his word and meditating on promises such as these. Philippians 1:20, 21. I have an earnest expectation and hope, Paul said, that with all boldness, Christ will even now, as always, be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Another one, Isaiah 41:10. Fear not, the prophet writes, for I am with you, God says. I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, and I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Then one of Mary's favorite verses, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to give you hope and a future, to do you good and not evil. Then Hebrews 13:5. Be content with what you have, for the Lord has said, I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you. So we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear. Therefore, with promises like these from the God whom Mary knew as her rock, the one who would never change, she knew that the Lord was with her. She could beat cancer, if not in this life, then certainly in the next, where she would experience ultimate healing. Cured with a resurrected and glorified body. She had the treasure of Jesus, his love and his truth, in a frail earthen vessel. She knew that the surpassing greatness of the power of God would rest on her life. It was not her power, but his power working through her. I want to paraphrase Paul's great testimony in this regard on Mary's behalf. So I do not lose heart, though my outer self is wasting away, my inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light, momentary affliction is preparing for me an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. As I look not to the things that I can see with my eyes, but to the things I cannot see. For the things I can see with my eyes are transient, but the things I cannot see are eternal. Mary could face cancer head on and know that it was ultimately powerless, because cancer cannot cripple love. It cannot shatter hope. Cancer cannot corrode faith, and it cannot devour peace. Cancer cannot destroy confidence, and it cannot kill friendship. It cannot shut out memories, and it cannot silence courage. Cancer cannot invade the soul, and it cannot diminish eternal life. It cannot quench the spirit, and it can never lessen the power of the resurrection. In spite of her increasing physical weakness, Mary could feel confident in her security in Christ, and in knowing that for whatever uncertainties cancer may bring, my hope, my salvation, my future are secure in Jesus, because he's given me his word. Not only will he never leave me, I'm certain he will never fail me. So as the treatments continued, the uncertainty of how things would turn out physically took a back seat to the certainty of her spiritual future in glory with the Lord. She was content that the Lord was answering her prayer in his own way. You see, the idea of hope for the believer is not some kind of wishful thinking with no clue as to how things are going to turn out. Rather, it is the absolute certainty for the believer that the promises in God's word will find their fulfillment in Christ. They will be realized in the believer's life, both now and in the future. Back to Romans in the 5th chapter, just a few verses here. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. Thus, hope for the Christian is the certainty that all of God's promises in Christ, as Paul said, are yea and amen, and they will be fulfilled in God's good time. So, Because Christ died and rose again, it's a done deal. Write it down. It's a sure thing. Mary lived and died with the hope in the Lord as a personal reality. It was a sure and steadfast anchor of her soul, as Paul, or as the writer of Hebrews, mentions in chapter 6. Again, she knew with Paul, no one lives to himself, no one dies to himself. For if we live, we are the Lord's. If we die, we are the Lord's. So whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. So on the basis of her previous experience of trusting God's word, Mary could say, for this hope, I had Jesus. Probably the great majority of you here who are here today know Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. There may be others who have professed faith in him for many years, but maybe you lack the assurance of his presence within your life and his saving grace to take you home. So easy to say that we believe God is sovereign, that his grace is sufficient when things are going well, isn't it? When our loved ones are taken from us, when some tragedy strikes unexpectedly, when pain and trouble seem to never end, the reality of what we believe is tested at those times and proved out. It's during those times that we need reminders of the truth of the Lord's complete, total, absolute sufficiency. God never promised to remove all the difficulties from our lives, but he did promise to be with us in them, to enable us to go through them by his all-sufficient grace. For those who knew Mary well, thank God for her life and testimony. For in her life we saw, lived out, the reality of one who leaned on the Lord and who found him to be all sufficient. So along with Hubert, Paige, Mary, each one of us would do well to take the words of this great hymn and inscribe them on the marquee of our lives for all the world to see. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' love and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but I wholly lean on Jesus' name. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All of the grand. Whatever the appearance, all other grim, whatever the promise that might be made, all other grim is sinking sand. For this hope, we who know Jesus have him to get us through. For this solid rock under our feet, she had Jesus, and we, by faith, do too. Let's pray together. Thank you, Father, for your grace that is always, now and forever, sufficient. Things come our way, we get blindsided by things that we cannot understand. We keep looking to you. You are our rock. Not just to hold on to, but under our feet to give us a foundation to stand whatever winds may blow, whatever Satan can throw at us. We want to run in the path of your testimonies, and so may our lives glorify you as Mary's did. We thank you for the promises of your word we've seen lived out in her life, and by faith we shall experience the same fulfillment of those promises in our life.